Well, for those who don't know me, my name's Eric Shadle, and I guess the best title I could say what I do is I'm a child of God, and my calling is to love people one person at a time. Some days I do that better than others. You can talk to my wife about that. I'm really excited to be part of the Centura South Denver Group hospital system and to be partnering with Newday in a way that I think is really significant. I think it's really exciting for us to have hospital system and a church talking about health, where oftentimes we think that health is over here in the hospitals, and the church is over here. We compartmentalize things all the time. That's what we have done over the course of the last several hundred years, as knowledge has increased, and we have more and more knowledge, and we have to compartmentalize because no one person can kind of master it all, right? So we kind of compartmentalize, and over the course of time, we've said that health care is really just a hospital, and yet I would suggest that we're both working on the same thing. The church and the hospital and health is really in the same thing, and we want to think about physical health over here and spiritual health over there, and really science is telling us more and more that they are together and that we have to address both of them in order to be healthy. And so I'm really excited to be a part of this series with Dave Kennedy, and he's out of town right now, but it's a series on creation health, and we've called it New Beginnings because it really is about new beginnings. And last week we talked about new beginnings and how we all need new beginnings every day. We spent quite a bit of time on that last week. And we realized that every new beginning has a context. There's a beginning before our beginning. In the beginning, the Word already existed. So in the creation story, it's really just the creation of us, not the creation of existence in and of itself. God already existed, and we can't really understand that. I think the quantum world is telling us a little bit about that, how that past, present, and future are all together. And maybe in the quantum world we can start getting an idea. Then I believe that quantum is the intersection of science and faith, where we're starting to see an understanding of God from science itself. But what we read about in John 1:1, that quantum says, yeah, that could really be true. And we believe by faith it is, that the Word was with God and the Word was God. It already existed. In our own experience, we talked about last week that when we are born, that's our new beginning, right? We are born, but to a family that already existed. Adam and Eve, when they were created in a world that already existed. And so they were created to trust, and were created for faith. Today, we're going to look at this thing as we look at new beginnings. We're going to look at this thing called choice. But to set that up, I just want to briefly go over my own story. In the video they showed last week, I just touch on it, but I don't want to spend a lot of time on this. But let me go back several years. I'm in Rockford, Illinois, practicing as an obstetrician, and a guy named Dr. Hans Diehl came to town. He has something called the CHIP program, the Coronary Health Improvement Project at the time. And Swedish American Hospital System brought him to Rockford. He actually stayed in our house for on and off for over a year. And the program that he had was the first time that the health message made sense because it was about science. Didn't seem like it was just this goofy thing over here. It really made sense to me. And so we embraced it, as our family did, changed our lives, started teaching it, been part of taking over 8,000 people through that program in Illinois and then in Washington State when I pastored in Washington State, where we collaborated with a local hospital to do that. So our church, a few years ago, did see that physical and mental and spiritual health were all connected. Well, what a shock to me, after all that, that in planning to take this bike ride that I took in 2012 across the country on my sabbatical to raise awareness and money for diapers, where families in this country, a third of families, cannot afford diapers. And that has all kinds of consequences. It's one of those social determinants of health. And so that was such a blessing to me. But before I went on that, as I'm training to go on that, because I was not a bike rider before I did that, I found that I was having impossible time getting up anything more than about a 4% grade hill. Okay, so I just couldn't do it. I didn't understand it. I'm used to pushing through pain, but I couldn't do it. It took me a few months to figure it out, but I finally decided to go see the doctor. And long story short, I ended up with heart surgery. Ended up with coronary bypass surgery. Now, that's not the worst of it. I kind of bounced back from that. I went across the country a few months later, rode my bike across. It was a great experience. And then, about a year after the procedure, I had chest pain again. Now I knew what it was. It was the exact same thing. And I was really discouraged. I mean, what is going on? So I went on a journey. I really resisted even getting an angiogram because I thought, I don't know what I thought. I was just really, really discouraged and upset. So I went on this journey to try to figure out what the determinants of personal health are. And lo and behold, I found out that finally did get an angiogram. And then it just showed that, as my doctor told me, probably just a failed graft. About 10% of people have a failed graft. And so I was in that 10%. So it was nothing that I had done. And yet I had already gone on a journey that ends up bringing me here to lead the Creation Health and initiatives here in the South Denver group of hospitals in Centura, and to create a program called Pathways to Health and Wellness that is actually just starting here in Parker. We had, by the way, partnering with Parker, we had room. We have two classes, one in the afternoon, one in the evening. We had a room for a total of about 80 people, 110 signed up. Good thing we already have classes starting in Littleton, and those people are going to go to Littleton. The point I really want us to think about here and to set up is that choices, especially in the health arena, are really confusing. Anybody experience that? Anybody go to a physician and, the choices that you're asked to make, it's like, I don't know. I don't know what to do. Choices are so important. And so today I do want to talk about the anatomy of choice. It's kind of interested to what Lisa said. She never thought of it as anatomy. And I guess maybe it's just my background. But, anatomy to me is like you figure out where everything fits together and how it operates. So anatomy and physiology kind of go together. And so we want to understand a little bit about choice. And I think that what we do with choice is we just assume that choice is good. The more choice you have, the better. That's this country. But before I talk about that, let me look at the creation acronym just real quick to bring us back up to speed on this. I see these this acronym, eight letters representing eight personal determinants of health. That's all it is. And we looked last week how they are baked into our very being in the Genesis, in the creation story in Genesis 1 and 2. And so the other thing to recognize here is that today we're going to look at choice, but choice affects every one of those other determinants, doesn't it? Because we have to choose everything, right? And yet, rest, we know for sure, affects our choice. If I don't get to sleep, when I get more tired, I make choices that I didn't think I wanted to make, right? Am I the only one that experiences that? Our environment really can determine some of the choices we make. If you're born in the inner city, I would say it's pretty hard to raise yourself up by your bootstraps when you don't have any bootstraps. You see, so all of these affect our choice. Every single one of those, the nutrition that we eat, the biochemicals that make up the building blocks to replace the over 50 trillion cells that's in our body, that atomic tracer studies tell us that 98.5% of those are changed every single year. We can have a new beginning with every meal we consume. Affects our choice because it affects our brain biochemistry. So choice in this country, it has exploded. Let me give you an example. The average grocery store in America has 285 varieties of cookies, 75 iced teas, 175 salad dressings, and 40 toothpastes. I've heard dentists say that we don't even know. We go there, we can't figure out what toothpaste to use. I just pick the one that looks the prettiest. And if it tastes good when I go home, I buy it again. One consumer electronics store, just one, believe it or not, you could have 6.5 million stereo systems constructed from what's within that store. When I was a kid, GM, Chrysler, and Ford were the only car companies in America, certainly, that we even cared about. What's that? American Motors, oh, yes. Well, I grew up in a GM town. We did not think American Motors existed. In fact, American Motors was so low on our priority that we would, believe it or not, even think about buying a Honda before we'd buy American Motors. But and Honda back then was like a joke. My dad would buy a new car every 3 years, the only choice he had to make. He had two choices. What color? And what model of Buick? It's the only choices he had. We either would get a special, and then I can remember when we got the LeSabre. Oh, my goodness, it's a beautiful car in the 70s. And my dad said, you know what? I'll never pay more than $3,000 for a car. And we got that LeSabre, and it was like $3,100. He goes, man, I don't know. We really pushed it on this one. Today, Business Insider lists 47 different car companies. And Porsche alone has 21 different versions of the 911. I'm not talking about colors, etc. I'm talking about different versions. In healthcare, your doctor will describe, here's your treatment options. Here's option A, risk benefits. Option B, risk benefits. Option C, perhaps. Sometimes even option D, none of the above. It's up to you. So you say, well, what do you recommend? Well, let me tell you about option A, risk and benefits. Option B, risk and benefits. Option C, risk and benefits. But doctor, what would you do? Well, I would carefully consider option A, option B, and option C, right? I mean, that's why? Because choice is sacred to us. want to tell us a, it's not really a story. What I'm going to do is recount something you could go and watch on TED Talk. Her name's Sheena Iyengar. She's a professor of business in the management division at Columbia University. And she gave a talk on the art of choice. Should have been called the anatomy of choice, but she chose wrongly and called it the art of choice. But that should not take away from the impact of her talk. She tells the story of Susan and Daniel Mitchell, who were about to have their first baby. They'd already named their baby girl, Barbara. Then she goes into premature labor at 7 months. She ends up with a C-section, and her baby, Barbara, had cerebral anoxia. She was born brain dead. She was on a breathing tube, and the doctors had that discussion with her. It's option A, option B. You can keep her alive, keep that tube in her. We see no hope, zero hope of her ever doing, chances are she won't live even with that, but if she does, she'll be in a vegetative state for as long as she does live. Option B would be to pull it out. They chose to pull it out, and she died. The doctors gave the Mitchells a choice to take her off life support or to keep her on it. Sheena decided to do a study and look at families with that same kind of issue in France and in America. And they looked at that, and they all ended up making the same decision, take the baby off life support. In France and in America. She follows up 1 year later to see the effect of that choice. The difference was, in France, the doctors made the decision. And in America, as we said, we make the decision. Here's what the parents in France had to say. She was with us for so little time, and yet she had such an impact. She taught us so much in that week or however many days she lived. She gave us a new perspective on life. The American parent said, "What if? What if? I feel like they purposely tortured me." These are quotes from the parents. "Why'd they make me do that? I feel like I've played a role in an execution." And yet the U.S. parents, when given the option, "Well, would you have rather the doctor choose?" "Oh, absolutely not. Absolutely not." Why? Because it's our culture. We really believe that we need choices. We think the more choices, the better. Could it be that we've been duped into accepting the assumption that I just stated, that more choices are better? Part of our problem in choices, because we have so many, many of us never have peace on any choice we make because there's so many other viable choices. I buy a new car, and a silver car, and I'm thinking, "Well, maybe I should have had a red one. I forgot this option. Maybe it would be so much, but this was a good choice." That's what happens when we have so many choices, and yet we think that's good. I would argue today that the ultimate choice is to understand that there's really only one choice that matters. That's because choice, the one choice behind the choices that we make, is the only thing that brings us blessings, peace, and joy. Let's look at that a little bit as we think about the question behind every choice. We're going to look in the creation story. And here we see in Genesis 3:1, "The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?" What does it mean to be shrewd? We're talking about the serpent. Scripture calls the serpent shrewd, having or showing sharp powers of judgment, astute, sharp-witted, smart, acute, intelligent, clever, canny, perceptive, wise. These are good things. I would suggest that perhaps, just perhaps, knowledge isn't everything. Let me suggest that we do not have to be smart to make the right choice. There are very few choices we make in which cognitive intelligence is primarily important. We don't like to hear that. And you probably don't even believe it right now. And maybe you won't by the time I'm done. And you'll think I'm stupid. That's okay. Let's just go on this journey together and see what we think. You see, again, the issue is discerning the choice behind our choices that make the difference in life. If we think about the question that the serpent asked, there's a question or an assumption behind the statement he's making. The question that he's asking Eve, the choices that he's asking her to make, if she just sticks with that and not go with the choice behind the choices that we have to make, she'll go in the wrong direction. I would suggest that knowledge without God's love and grace is very, very often dangerous. Think of a nuclear physicist can save the world or destroy it. It depends on the choice behind the choices. Think of a landlord, could be the wealthiest landlord in the world, and this person could impact the lives of thousands and thousands of people for good, or almost destroy them, based on the choice behind the choices the person makes. Same with a physician, a lawyer. Physician, I had a partner for 2 years. Only 2 years. Because as a physician, very talented guy, but was overcoding on Medicare patients. And I was not going to be a part of that. Where he's billing for things he did not do. Custodian. My father was a firefighter. He retired, became a custodian of public schools. And I can remember as a kid, because my dad, he was older when I was born. And so I was probably maybe a freshman, sophomore in high school when he had retired and was doing this. And I would go with him every Sunday to the elementary school. And you know why he went there on Sunday? He didn't get paid. He went there because he had talked to every one of those teachers. He knew what they liked. And he made sure their room was set up exactly the way they wanted to start Monday morning. And they had a gym there, and I'd go in and shoot hoops and run around. It was fun. Sometimes take a friend, and we'd play some one-on-one. It's the choice behind the choices. And so this highly intelligent creature, the serpent, asks a question. As smart as the serpent is being manipulative, is not being honest, and is asking a leading question to go in the wrong direction. Side note, questions are some of the most important things we have in our lives to have new beginnings, to change the direction of our lives. We don't change without questions that we ask ourselves, that our friends ask us, that we listen to God asking us, always, though, look for the question behind the question, because the real question that the serpent was asking Eve that day was, do you really trust God? Do you really have faith in Him? You know, we accept knowledge from sources we trust. And if we do not trust the source, we're skeptical of the knowledge. Eve had to distrust God to choose the way she went. She had to say that God is not trustworthy, that I can do this on my own. And so I think we have to look at the impotence, not the importance, the impotence of knowledge. We falsely assume that knowledge will save us, and it's not true. If it were, once we knew how to get out of debt and that debt enslaves us, we'd never get in debt again. If that were true and we really understood what foods to eat, we'd eat them. Because the knowledge tells us, but we don't make decisions that way. We really don't. Because we are complex beings, and I would suggest it's because God created us that way. He created us with a heart. And unless knowledge connects to the heart, I would say it's almost useless. And even worse, often dangerous. So, Genesis will go on in the story. Of course, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, the woman replied. It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we're not allowed to eat. God said, you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die. Eve has knowledge. She understands. She gets it. And she is steadfast in her knowledge. Have you ever been steadfast in your knowledge? And then you go and do something, you make a choice that you really didn't want to make, and you wonder, why do I make that choice? I don't want to do that. I've sworn off dessert, and I swore it off that morning, and this evening, we're at a restaurant, and I go, well, it's just an exception. Right? I may never get to this restaurant again. Or they may take this off the menu. And where am I going to be in life? So therefore, I will eat it. And I'm not really violating what I said I wouldn't do, even though I'm doing what I said I wouldn't do. We rationalize a lot, don't we? I would say that Eve is confident right now. She knows what she needs to do. So can knowledge really save us? Oh, you won't die. He's using knowledge again, trying to reason with her. The serpent replied, God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you'll be like God, knowing both good and evil. And just like that, the woman was convinced. Just like that. Just like, not going to eat any more dessert. Dear, you hold me accountable. No more dessert. They may take it off the menu. I better have it, I'm convinced. We do it all the time. This resonates with me. Knowledge is not enough. Absolutely not enough. She knows the choice. She knows the one choice. She knows she needs to trust. She was created to trust. She had a loving relationship with God. And yet she had a false confidence. We become overconfident, I believe, in those things that we want. We end up with blind spots. We all have blind spots. Things that we actually don't think is wrong with us. We don't see it. They're blind. That's why they're blind spots. That's why we have friends. Friends help us see blind spots. Accomplices do not. most of us choose friends that are accomplices, people that tell us what we want to hear rather than what we need to hear. God creates us to be in relationship with one another, to help us make the right choices, the right choice behind the choices. See, it's so much easier. We went to this Mongolian grill, Huhat or something like this. We've only been there one time. I love Mongolian grills, but I don't know, I hate chains. And so for this one day we decided to go there. And I was amazed when I opened up, they have this whole menu for drinks. And soda pop, they have, I swear, they must have 40 different options. I'm thinking, wow, what's the one choice for me? Soda or no soda? No soda, no sugar drink for me. Okay, this is fascinating. Almost makes me think it's a good thing. I mean, it'd have to be a good thing. Soda has to be a good thing, right, if you'd have that many choices. Why would you? I mean, so choice becomes this thing that we get stuck in the choices rather than the choice behind it. Those who do not know Jesus really only have friends to help along the way with choices. Those of us who accept Jesus and lean into Him and His Spirit also gain another voice, a voice that can live within us, that can give our minds, that can open our minds and our hearts to the right choice behind the choices. Absolutely key. And so we read what Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." I was raised in an atmosphere that knowledge was everything, that I had to know everything. In fact, I had to know everything that was going to happen in the time of the end, and if I didn't get it figured out in the right timeline, I could be saved. I could be lost. And that's the proof. The truth will set you free. Well, there's some truth in that, but I believe the real truth that will set me free is Jesus in my heart, the Spirit telling me, correcting the negative voices in my head, the misbeliefs that I have that are driving the wrong choices because I'm not making the right choice. Does that make sense? That the truth will set me free because He will tell me who I really am. He will tell me what choice I need to make in my life. And you know what? Each of us has that same choice, and that is a fundamental determinant of our health. Fundamental. And no one else in this world knows what choice you need to make. I cannot write a program and say, okay, here's one diet, you all need to choose this. Absolutely not. Because I don't know your genetics, I don't know the environment that you've grown up in, and you may need a different diet, you may need a different exercise program, you may need different all kinds of things than I need, and a different choice behind that. And we all tell ourselves lies. When I talked about the dessert, making a decision in the morning, changing my mind in the evening, I've told myself a lie. The Spirit can tell us the truth, who we are. And so let's finish up this Genesis account as we look at the power of choice. We already read this. The woman was convinced. She saw that the tree was beautiful, the one she's not supposed to eat from. And its fruit looked delicious. And she wanted the wisdom it would give her all really good things. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. At that moment, their eyes were opened. The hardest lies to discover are those that are mixed with truth. At that moment, their eyes were open. They suddenly felt shame. Shame at their nakedness. Shame is something that's put on us that we feel. Have you ever felt ashamed? Something that you've done, you just did, or something you've done in the past? Sometimes we have shame that from something that we did 30 years ago. And it can hang on. And what does it do? It isolates us. Exactly what God knows is the most injurious thing in our lives, is to be isolated, to not have godly friends, not to have a church community that can be open and transparent and say, yes, I have that issue. I was in Washington State, as I said, when I had my heart surgery, and I've been working with the hospital, and I felt so ashamed that I had heart disease, that I went to the head nurse for the hospital, the CNO, and I said, you know what, because I'd been working with her on this program, I said, you know, I don't think I should do this program. I can't teach this. She said, oh, no, you can. It's powerful. Just tell your story. Well, I don't want anybody to know my story. I don't want anybody to know. When I wrote this program, that story is front and center because I want people to know that doesn't matter where we've been. Only matters where we're going. And that we can all have a new beginning no matter what. It is the choice behind the choices that is the only choice that brings blessing, peace, and freedom. We are truly free when we understand that, so that we don't have to worry about making this choice, but I'd be better off if I would have made this other choice. And so we see that Jesus sent His Holy Spirit to us to be with us, to guide us, to speak to us. He says, and when He comes, He will convict the world of its sin. Let's just personalize that. He's going to convict me of what's wrong. But He's not going to stop there. What is He going to do? He's going to convict me of what's right. That is what drives the choice that I make. And the real choice is whether or not I'm going to listen to the Spirit. And of the coming judgment. What does that mean? That is the sovereignty of God that I am saved by His grace. I'm not saved by the knowledge I have. Truth, after all, is a person. It's Jesus Christ in my life, speaking in my head and my heart. That's why He wants my heart, because He knows that knowledge is impotent without my heart connected to my brain. And so, every moment of every day can be a new beginning. May you identify this week the choice behind the choices in your life. May you seek Jesus and listen to the Holy Spirit speak truth in your life. May the choice you make today, as you are faced with the myriad of choices, be for eternity. What would the next steps look like? I won't presume to tell you what your steps look like, but I would suggest perhaps spend time this week with a friend, not an accomplice. Seek out a true friend. Spend time with Jesus this week. That's what works for me. Maybe there's something else that you need to do. I need to exercise vigorously in order to feel that connection and have my mind open. And you may not need to do that. But focus on the choice. Identify each day this week when the choice actually was the driver behind the choices that you're making.